And let y2 just be 0, right? Do that. And then go to, so then graph them. And then do second, at least on the TI. I'm always writing TI instructions. Second, calc, and then choose intersect. On that, choose intersect. And then when you do the intersect, you just hit enter, enter. The first two, don't even worry about it at all. Just enter, enter. And then move near first intersection and hit enter. And then you just keep redoing this 3 times, right? Remember that game plan? So that's how you just do that real quick. You have your graphic echoes. You have the Casio. It's a little different. There's only a couple of you with Casio. So it's actually kind of easier with Casio. So if you have the Casio, go ahead and do what you need to do for Casio. Casio, there's a real easy way with roots. If you don't know, come up after class. I went online yesterday with somebody, so it's fresh in my mind. I can help the Casio people. If you have a Casio and you're not sure, come up after class. Probably take just 20 seconds, and I can show you. It's real nice. You just graph them, and you hit. Well, I can tell you, it's F5. You graph them, and you just put in Y1. For the Casio people, just put in Y1. Don't even worry about Y2. Just put in Y1, and hit graph it, and then hit F5. And then hit F1, I think it is. And it just starts finding the roots for you automatically. It's real nice, real easy. So come up if you want help on that. All right, we getting that? Maybe I'll do it real quick. Make sure it's all working. So make sure you use the negative. You know, it's real touchy about the difference between negative and subtract, right? Joe got that copy down, so I'm going to go to the Elmo real quick. And we'll take a look. Okay, so there, see, I've typed in Y1. So negative x cubed minus 5. So there's a difference then. Here, let me just bring this down where I can touch it. So this is a subtraction, right? And that's a negative. See how it's negative is a little smaller, right? I use the negative. So negative x cubed minus 5 halves x squared, right? Just 5 over 2. You might have a nicer, newer TI that does it all, you know, vertically, which is even nicer. Great, whatever. Mine's the old kind that just does it all in one line. 5 halves, 5 over 2, 5 divided by 2, x squared plus 5 divided by 4, x plus 3. All good there. And y2 equals 0. If a couple people came by and were asking me, if any of these plots are, if any of these plot 1, plot 2, plot 3, if they're highlighted, right, let me show you, let me just do it. It'll mess you all up, and you need to go up there, let me see, enter. So you see how that's highlighted now? That'll cause a problem, that'll cause a syntax error. So if that's the case, just go up to whichever one's highlighted with your arrows, and just hit enter. It just turns it off, it's like a light switch, off and on. So just turn it off, make sure all those plots are off, and make sure both equal signs. See how both these equal signs for Y1 and Y2 are highlighted? That means it those are on, so to speak. It's going to graph those when you hit the graph button. Make sense? Hit the graph button. I don't even know what my window is. Probably negative 10, positive 10, which seems perfect. So I'm just negative 10, positive 10, negative 10, positive 10. That's great. Y2, where's Y2? Why, it looks like it only graphed one graph. Where's Y2?
Off screen.
It's just right this. It's the x-axis because it's at a height of 0. It's y height 0, right? That was so y2 is the x-axis on that. On your nice color ones, you can see it. So, all right, so we're looking for the intersection. So we got that good. So I'm going to hit second, calc right here. See the calc up there? Mm-hmm. My finger's gigantic. All right, second, calc, right? And come on down to intersect. Hit enter. And see, now don't even worry about first curve, second curve, whatever. Just hit enter, enter, just like I told you. First curve, second curve, enter. Now guess means move close to the intersection you're looking for. Where's the intersection? Right here. Remember, the other line is the x-axis. It's y0, height 0. Right? This is the line that goes through the y-axis at a height of 0, isn't it? It's the x-axis. So go. So here's the first intersection, second, and third. I don't care about that y-intercept. That's not what I'm looking for. I'm looking for these three x-intercepts. Why? Because that's the intersection between the other graph is the x-axis, not the y. Right? So it's the curvy curve and the x-axis where they intersect these three x-intercepts. So go near the first one. I'll go over here near the first one. That's my guess. So I said hit enter, enter. Go near the first one, enter. Boom. It found it. Negative 2.52, which is what I had in the screen already. Negative 2.52, that's the first one. Now you got to redo it. So I'll hit second calc again to find the second one. Go on down to intersect. Hit enter, enter, enter. The first two enters, don't even worry about it. Now move close to the second intersection. There I am close to the second. Enter for the third time. There's the second answer, negative 1.07. Do it again. Second calc. Go down to intersect. And then enter, enter. First curve, second curve. Enter, enter. Who cares? Guess. Now go close over here to that one. Enter. There it is. 1.10 on that. All right, good questions on that. So there's the three answers on that. We all good? Have any trouble, grab me after. I better move ahead. But I do want to show you because there's stuff on both sides. So this is a big ugly one. This is a graphing calculator again. Again, I'm not going to do it. I'm just going to say this. If you have a TI, you just let that be Y1. You let that be Y2 on the TI, right? That's what you do. If you have for Casio, if you have a Casio, then you probably use a different method. I don't know. Again, you can do a YouTube. But what you could do is you could bring these guys to the other side because the Casios like to get a zero on the right side. So you could do it that way, right? You could just say, hey, just leave the minus 5, 6x to the fourth minus 3x cubed plus 7 halves x, and then jump this guy to the other side. Remember when things jump to the other side, they change signs, right? Be plus 5 halves x squared, and then the plus half jumps to the side, minus a half equals 0, right? So you could just bring everything over there, and then you got it equal to 0, and then just do your normal thing on the Casio. So that's what the Casio people would probably need to do. Then they can do their root function. They do F5, they graph it. For the Casio people, they graph it. They hit F5, and then I think they hit F1, find roots. Roots mean you got to have a zero. That's what a root means. So you got to get a zero first before you do that. So for the Casio people, do that. For the TI people, just left side Y1, right side Y2, do the intersect thing like we just did. Same thing. All right, I'm going to move on from there. All right, so number 9, x plus 5 over 7. Let me go over fractions with you because these are a problem. X plus 4 over 3 equals 2. All right, guys and gals, what do we do when we're trying to solve something and there's fractions, denominators?
Multiply by the denominator.
Multiply by common denominator, huh? We just get them out of there. Pretty much my strategy with fractions is get rid of them. Get them out of there. So what's the common denominator? Yeah, looking at 3 and 7, 21, right? You just multiply the denominators together. 3 times 7, 21. So what do I do with the 21? You multiply 21 to that fraction, 21 to that fraction, 21 to that fraction. Top, top, top. Here's the equals, right? Just doing both sides of the equal sign, right? If they were equal before, treat them the same, they'll still be equal, right? So now, with that 21, I cross-cancel and multiply what's left over, right? So 7 goes into 21 three times, and that leftover 3 multiplies, so I get 3x plus 15. Good for that first fraction, right? I cross-canceled 7 into 21. And the leftover 3 multiplied. So cross-cancel, multiply leftovers. Try that next one in the middle. 3 goes into 21, right? So you can do that one. Three goes into 21 7 times. Multiply, multiply. 7x plus 28. Is that good there? And 2 times 21, 42. Does that good? Are we all good there so far? So we got rid of fractions, huh? No more fractions. Much nicer. That's the most important step there. Now we just gather like terms. 3x and 7x is 10x. 15 and 28 is some big number. 43?
Yep.
Equals 42 like that. All right. And now, what do we do from there? Subtract that 43. Like that. 10x equals negative 1. Last step to get x alone, divide by 10. There it is. Negative 1 tenth. Is that all good? You all good with all those algebra things? Mm-hmm. I want to be sure to review them all because I know algebra is real important, especially as you're going into calculus, to get really, really comfortable with all kinds of algebra. Anything I can say? We good with all that? All right. Okay, so number 12. X squared minus x minus 20 is 0. Okay, so try that one. How do you solve x squared equations? This is an x squared equation, right? It's not just x to the first. How do you solve x squared with an equal sign? Well, step one is you got to get a 0, but this one already has a 0, so that's good. Step two is you try to factor. Remember, you know, like the parentheses? You know, can you factor that one? That's how you would solve that one, right? Try to factor that one. See what you remember about factoring. It's important for us to review factoring in here. Let's try that. So remember how the factoring thing works? So, remember you multiply to be the back number and you add to be the middle number? Middle number is the negative one there. Remember that? Mm-hmm. It's also FOIL. That's how it is formally, right? Which means front times front to make front. First, outer, inner, last. So first in this parenthesis times first in that parenthesis to make the first one there. Okay. And then last times last to make last. So what times what makes 20? What multiplies to be 20? Well, a few things, huh? 4 times 5, 2 times 10, 1 times 20, they all multiply to be 20. How do you know which one you want to use?
You want something that nearly cancels itself out.
Yeah, you want to add to be negative 1. So which of those could somehow do a negative 1, 4 and 5, huh? So you put 4 here, 5 there, vice versa. The order doesn't matter right now, but the signs do matter. How do the signs go?
Bigger number to have the negative.
Yeah, the sign in the middle always goes on the bigger, right? Sign in the middle. Sign on the bigger. Let me write that for you. Sign in middle goes on the bigger. So the negative in the middle goes on the 5, right? Minus 5 plus 4 makes negative 1, and they multiply to be negative 20, huh? Now, we don't stop there. That's factoring. Now you set each one gets their own 0. Remember that? Why? Well, because if two things times to equal 0, either one could be 0 to make that true, huh? If I said, hey, I'm thinking of two things, they're timesing, I'm timesing them in my head, answer's coming out 0. What does that mean? The first one could be 0, because 0 times anything would make the answer 0. Or the second number could be 0, because anything times 0 would make the answer come out 0, huh? Either one could be 0 if they're timesing and the answer's coming out 0. So that's what these guys do. These two things are timesing and the answer's equaling 0. So that means the first one could be 0, or the second one could be 0. And you know how to solve. Just jump it to the other side. It just changes the signs, huh? Negative 4 and positive 5. So those are the two answers. They just want you to type in negative 4, positive 5 with a comma. No parentheses or anything. It's not graphing or anything. Either order. You can put them either order like that. Is that good? You remember all that from algebra? Things I can say to help or remind you of? That good? I'm assuming, you know, that you're half rusty like everybody is from algebra, so I want to help clean that up. So let me know as we run into things that you're a little rusty on with algebra, because that is an important focus. Okay, I'll keep moving. It's harder factoring. So 2x squared equals x plus 6. Okay, so same thing. What I just wrote out the x squared strategy. Step one is you got to get a 0. It's all about getting that 0. So your first step on, when you see x squared, equation, first step is to get a 0. So you want to grab this x and jump it, and grab this 6 and jump it. So you'll get 2x squared minus x minus 6 equals 0. I'll let you take it from there.
So that's the first step, though. Always get a zero. And then try to factor, right, with parentheses.
Or, you know, if you don't want to factor, or some of them just won't factor, what else could you do instead of factoring? Do you remember? Quadratic formula, negative b plus or minus square root of b squared minus 4ac all over 2a. You get a 3x5 card for the test. You could just write, I would definitely write that right on your 3x5 card for the test. Write all these instructions if you want. Anyway, some people prefer to just do that because factoring can be difficult. Like this is a harder factoring one. Factoring can be difficult. If you want, you can just plug it right into the quad. It's kind of nice. It just cranks out the answers. It'll solve every x squared equation. You can just do the quad all the time if you want. Or you can factor. If you're a good factorer, then factoring will be quicker. But if you're a little rusty, the quad might be better either way. So do whichever you prefer. But you do need to know the quad because sometimes they actually won't factor at all. This one will factor. So you have options.
Right, I'm going to jump in with the factoring.
Okay, so FOIL. So this kind's a harder. Why is this one harder? It's got a number in the front. When you have a number in the front, they're a little harder. So you look back at the last one. We had just a 1 in the front of that last one. So those are easier factoring. The order doesn't matter at all. Whereas this one, you have a number other than 1 in the front, like a 2 or something. Those are harder. So just more possibilities. So front times front to make front. So that would be 2x and x. Not bad so far. Mm-hmm. The order on the first two don't matter. You can put x here and 2x there, whatever, doesn't matter. But now the order on the back two will matter because the fronts are different. Mm-hmm. See, somebody's going to be in a parenthesis with a 2x and somebody's going to be with a regular x. That's going to matter. Whereas the last one, they both just were with an x. That's why who cares what the order is. The signs mattered, but the order didn't because they were both just with an x because the front was just simple x squared. So those are easier. When the front is something other than simple x squared, then these are different, and now the orders matter and there's more complexity. So anyway, what times what? We need last times last to make 6. What times what is 6? Well, 2 times 3 or 1 times 6. Which one should I try? Usually try the numbers closer together. It's usually like 2 and 3, which are only 1 apart, instead of 6 and 1, which are 5 apart. Usually. Not always. They could do the 6-1 thing. But it's usually numbers that are closer together, like 2 and 3. So I'll try 2 and 3 first off. Now, when I put in 2 and 3, it's not going to be that order. Let me just put it in. Let me just show you why it's wrong. There's a couple of reasons. So first off, let me just put that in and say, well, maybe it's 2 and 3. No, notice, no signs yet. I'll do the signs later. There's too much to worry about. I do the signs. This is my style. There's a million ways to factor. Some people do the diamond thing. Some people do whatever you want. I never care. Anything's fine. I'm just showing you one way. So my way is just guessing. I'm simply just guessing around and foiling until it works, you know. There's nothing magical about my way. So front times front makes front. I'm just imagining. If I foiled this thing, would it work? Front times front would make front, yeah. Last times last would make 6. Other than the negative, I'll get that later. But how about the middle? What number's in the middle?
1.
Negative 1, really, right? Well, how do you make the middle? Oi. What does oi mean? To outer, to inner. That's what the oi stands for. Outer, outer, inner, inner, huh? So what's the inner times the inner here make? Well, 2x. And what's the outer times the outer make? 2x times 3? 6x. So now, can those two somehow make the middle? What's the middle? Negative 1x. You're supposed to put, that down there. Can they do it?
No.
6 and 2 make 8, or if you subtract them, it's 4. It's not going to make negative 1 anyway. So we know this is not the right order, so we try right away to swap the order. Not only that, by the way, let me give you even a second reason. Maybe some of you already know. You're never going to have two numbers in the same parenthesis that have anything in common, let alone are the very same number. You're never going to have 2 with 4, or 2 with 6, or 3 with 9, or 3 with 12. You're never going to have two numbers in the same parenthesis that have anything in common. You can't have 2 with 2. No way. Why not? Because they would have 2 in common. Well, so what? Why is that the end of the world? Well, because
If you had 2x plus 2, for example, one of the parentheses, you could take 2 out, right? Okay, so what? Well, back in the beginning, if there was anything in common, I would have done that then, right? Look in the beginning. Do they all have a 2 in common? No, the one in the middle doesn't. There was no GCF in the beginning. There was no 2 in common to all of them in the beginning. So how could there be a 2 showing up later? There can't be. Does that make sense? You do all the commonness right in the beginning, if there is any. So there's not going to be any commonness later in the parentheses. So for that reason, even quicker, I know no way 2x and 2 in the same parenthesis. No way. I don't even need to do all the oi stuff. No way, no way. Okay, so let me get back to it then. So what was the other possibility for 6? It was 3 here, 2 there to make the 6, right? Mm-hmm. 2 inner makes 3x. 2 outer makes 4x. And here's the middle, negative 1x. How can, if you can read all my scribbles here, let me try this again. So these 2 inner are making 3x. Okay, so how can 3x and 4x make the middle term negative 1x? Yeah, they can do it. They can do it. Now, here's where you might get confused by my instructions. I said sign in the middle, sign in the bigger. You guys all tracking with me on all this? I don't mean bigger up here yet. My focus is not up there yet. It may not be the bigger up there. It's the bigger among these guys. So who's bigger, 3 or 4? 4. Sign in the middle. Now I'm going to do the signs finally. Sign in the middle is negative, so the sign on the 4 is negative. And the 3 is positive, right? Plus 3 minus 4 is negative 1. We good? Everybody see that? So now, well, how do they get up here? Well, up, you can tell this is plus. This must be plus on this guy. And this must be minus on this guy. Minus 2 times 2 is minus 4. Notice, in the end, the minus I ended up on the smaller, actually, of the two numbers in the parentheses. So you got to be a little careful. When I say sign in the middle, sign in the bigger, I mean bigger among these two. Not necessarily the ones in the parentheses. Remember all that from algebra? Sort of? All right, so now, can we finish this thing up?
Yep.
Now that we have the parentheses, we got it factored. We say, okay. So now the first one, 2x plus 3 is 0, or the second one, x minus 2 is 0. Jump it over, 2x is minus 3, divide by 2, boom. Jump it over, boom. So the answers are minus 3 halves, positive 2. There we go. Good. Now, it might have been easier just to do the quadratic formula, if you remember how to do that. Might have just been easier. Minus 3 halves, positive 2. Remember the old quad? I'm not going to do the quad right now. Maybe I could do the quad. All right, you guys all got that copy down? So 2x squared equals x plus 6. Here, or actually I'll just paste it again. So, all right, so let me do the quad real quick. So what do we have? We had 2x squared minus x minus 6 when we brought them over. So, and then, so the quadratic formula, so negative b plus or minus square root of b squared minus 4ac. This is, I'll say, or do it this way, all over 2a. So this is a. B is negative 1, C is negative 6, right? Plug them in. Now, you got negative signs in the formula. So negative B, and B itself is negative 1. It's going to end up being positive there, right? B squared, negative 1 squared, minus 4 times A times C, which is negative 6, all over 2A. So I just plugged everything in. Remember that from your algebra days? And then this is going to, these guys here are going to make plus 1, a regular 1, right? Plus or minus the square root. Notice that bar goes all the way across. Common mistake of algebra students is to think it's only over the back. It's all the way. This is 1. Check out the signs in here. Be careful with your signs. 2 negatives, right? Negative 4 times positive, 2 times negative 6. 2 negatives is positive. 4 times 2 is 8, times 6 is 48. Over 2 times 2 is 4. That's 1 plus or minus the root of 49 over 4. That's 1 plus or minus 7 over 4. We good so far? I just rooted the 49, which is 7. The root vanishes after you root something, right? So it's 1 plus or minus 7 over 4. Let's do those two options. 1 plus 7 over 4 or 1 minus. So you just break them into the two. That's what the plus or minus means. Shorthand for two complete different fractions. Right? 1 plus 7 and 1 minus 7 over 4. So just work them out. What is that? 8 over 4, better known as 2. And this is minus 6 over 4. Reduce it. Minus 3 halves. Same two answers. So you might prefer just to do that. Don't factor at all. whatever you like. It'll work either way.
Questions on that? Remember all that from your glorious algebra days?
All right. All right. We'll do this one too. X cubed plus x squared minus 4x minus 4. Yeah, that's a hard one. Factoring one. Remember how to factor four terms from algebra? You do two and two, first two, last two, right? Because there's nothing in common to all of them. They don't all have an x. This four doesn't have an x. There's no number they all have. There's nothing in common to all of them. And it's not three terms. See, if it was three terms, I would just do the FOIL thing, right? Mm-hmm. Or I could solve by the quadratic formula. But I can't solve this by the quadratic formula because it's x to the third, right? Quadratic formula is only for x to the second, right? So you see, I need a special kind of factoring here. Everybody with me? Mm-hmm. See why I'm doing something special? If it was just three terms, I'd just do what the FOIL like I did last time or the quad. But it's four terms. So when it's four terms, you got four terms, do a 2-2 split. So the first two, just pretending the problem is just those two, what did just those two alone have in common?
X
squared, right? Take out x squared, leaves x plus 1. Take out the greatest amount they have in common, which would be x squared. That's the most they share, right? Good. Now, the back two, what do they have in common? Negative 4. Take out the negative 4. Now, what goes in the parentheses? Well, whatever works. Negative 4 times what will go back to negative 4x? Well, x. And negative 4 times what? Careful here. Oh, we'll go back to negative 4? Plus 1, which is nice because it matches the other one. Good so far? Now, a lot of students get tricked on the next step. Let me show you. Let me help with it. What you guys tell me, what if I had x squared w minus 4w? And I wanted to factor it, equals 0 or whatever. You know, how would I factor that? What would they have in common?
W.
Well, w, it'd be cake. No one would have any trouble at all with it. They go, well, just take out the w. No big deal. Right. What if instead of a w, they had like a parenthesis w? Well, okay, whatever, take out a parenthesis w. Just whatever they have, matching, common, you put it in the front, right? Mm-hmm. What if instead of a parenthesis W, oh, by the way, would I put W squared? There's two of them. No, just one. Because that one could distribute back, right? You just need one. That one would go back, right? Okay, I just want to be clear on that. So now, what about instead of a W, parenthesis W, what if instead we had a parenthesis X plus 1? Well, same thing. Put a parenthesis x plus 1. That's what we have. You see that? They both have a parenthesis x plus 1. It's just what they have in common. It's no big deal. It's just the common piece. And it's not squared. Just one of them could go back, couldn't it? So you just put one of them in the front, remove it, start a new set of parentheses, drop down the leftovers, x squared minus 4. Right? That's just GCF. That's just taking out what's in common. It's just a big common piece. They both have a parenthesis x plus 1, don't they? Good. Okay, now, there's one more step to our factoring here, isn't there? Do you see it? What's this guy want to do? He says, I need one more step. And by the way, why would we even think about doing it again? He's x squared. He's higher power. So we think he might go again. Does he break down?
Yeah,
x plus 2. What if... I'm asking too many questions. So x plus 1, and then this guy is... Remember it? X plus 2, x minus 2? Difference of squares, they call that, right? Because if we FOIL that, it'd be x squared minus 4. Hey, by the way, here's the part that a lot of people don't remember. What if this was x squared? What if it had been plus 4? It wasn't. But what if it was plus 4? Would this how would this factor then?
X squared 2.
Would it be x plus 2, x plus 2?
No,
it would
be x plus 2 squared.
It wouldn't factor at all. That's very important that you know that. Very important. And a lot of people don't know that. X squared plus 4 cannot be factored. It may not be factored. So watch out. That's coming. That'll be in some of our work in days to come and on some of our tests. And a lot of people don't understand it. They think, it's just plus 2. No, it's not. Check it. X squared plus, I'll just check it real quick to prove it's not. Plus 2x plus 4. What's that in the middle? 4x. It's supposed to go back to this. It's not. See? It's not true. So x squared plus 4 cannot be... So the whole difference of squares, why do they call it a difference of squares? Because it's got to be a difference, not an adding of squares. Does that make sense? It can't be plus there. Real important. Make sure you're aware of that. That minus is absolutely crucial. It's the only way it can factor. All right. Anyway, having said all that, there we go. It does factor because it is minus. That does work. So then you set each one equal to their own zero. And really, you know what it's going to do now. It's just going to be opposite sign of all these guys, huh? Just jump it over, jump it over, jump it over. So negative 1, negative 2, positive 2. There we go. We good with all that? All that algebra stuff coming back? Do you remember what I'm talking about? If that had been plus 4, that doesn't factor. You really want to file that away. Write that down. That's really important. X squared minus 4 does factor x plus 2, x minus 2, because the middle term drops out. If you FOIL it, right? X squared minus 2x and then plus 2x. See how the middle drops out? That works great for minus. It doesn't work for plus. You can't make them both plus because you'd have a plus 4x in the middle. So remember that, really important. All right, there we go. I plan to be through this section in like 15 minutes or something. It ain't working out. All right, so we're almost through this section. So square root of y plus 5 equals 5.
What do you do when you got a root in there? Second power. Yeah, you comfortable? Roots and two powers are opposites of each other, huh?
So when you got a root, so when you have a root, you go, let me do it this way, parentheses 2 power, parentheses 2 power, both sides. That's what you do. So you go parentheses 2 power, parentheses 2 power. And are you aware that that just cancels out the root? Just eliminates. Roots and 2 powers are opposites. It just makes y plus 5. And this is 25. 5 squared. We good with that? Pretty good with that whole thing? Okay, so then roots and 2 powers are opposite. So now finish solving. Subtract 5 on both sides. Y is 20. So once you get rid of the root, it's an easy problem. You just 2 power both sides gets rid of the root. Why does that get rid of the root? Well, you guys know that two of the same roots are one plane, do you? Do you remember that from your algebra days? Root 3 is root of 9, which is plane 3, right? So notice, two identical items in a root leads to one out of the root, doesn't it? I tell my algebra students, roots are a 2-for-1 deal at Target. That's what they are. That's what they do, right? You got two of the same thing, two threes in roots, that leads to one out. Two in the store, one out of the root, right? That's what roots always do. So that's why this 2 power cancels the root, do you see? Because it makes two of the roots, doesn't it? 2 power means two of them. And what do two identical roots do? One out. That's what's happening. That's why 2 powers cancel roots. All right, I like to give the reasons. I don't like to just say things without skipped it, huh? Yeah, it's a painful one. Wise to skip it until further instruction. Yeah. All right, let's take a look at it. 1 over x plus 2 plus 7 over x minus 1, negative 3 over 2. All right, fractions.
What do we do when we got fractions? Get them out of there by multiplying through by the common denominator, huh? That's what we always do. What's a common denominator? All that stuff. All those denominators. Just put them all together, right?
So I'm just going to go, I'll put the 2 in the front. Just because I guess I'm used to seeing it. Doesn't matter, though. You can do whatever you want. 2x plus 2x minus 1. 2x plus 2x minus 1. 2x plus 2x minus 1. You with me? I just did the
2x plus 2x minus 1 over all 3. That's what we always do with fractions, right? Common denominator, top, top, top. Then what?
Cross cancel. Multiply what's left over. So, x plus 2 cancels x plus 2. What's left over? 2 x minus 1. You can multiply right now or do it in a minute. It's going to be 2x minus 2 in a second, right? Mm-hmm. Either way, now or later, whatever. Plus, okay, can you do the middle one? We're trying to get rid of fractions. So do that middle one. X minus 1's cancel. What's left over? Well, so you multiply the leftovers, right? 7 times 2 is 14. It's going to multiply through x plus 2 in a second. You can do it right now, 14x plus 28, if you want, or do it in a minute.
Good so far? All right, I multiplied the LCD, common denominator, top, cross-cancel, and multiply the leftovers. What happens over here? 2 cancels 2. What's left over? Minus 3 and x plus 2, x minus 1. No more fractions. Right? We got rid of the fractions. So we always do step 1. Okay, that's the most important step. Things I can answer on that, so I'm going to do some more. But is that good? Okay on that step? So that's what you need to practice. You know, try that on your own. Make sure you can do that. It's one thing to watch the math teacher do it. It's another thing, you know, I watched a million lectures, a million math teachers do stuff, and it all made, well, a lot of times it didn't make sense. But sometimes it did make sense, and yet I'd go home and start doing the homework, and I'd go, what did that teacher do again? It all seems different. Right? So you got to make sure you do that on your own homework, practice those. All right, so let's distribute. 2x minus 2, distribute, 14x plus 28. And now this gets a lot of people over here. Let me help over here. That's cake. You all know how to do that. But right over here, I would do the parentheses first. You don't have I don't want to confuse you and say too many things. You could let the minus 3 distribute here first and then FOIL. What you cannot do, what's illegal, is to let the minus 3 go to this parenthesis and that parenthesis. You can't distribute twice. You see, you can't distribute through one guy and then through another. That's doubly multiplying the negative 3. That'll be wrong. You get the wrong answer. Do anything other than that, basically. You're fine. You can multiply just these first two and then FOIL. Because of that confusion, I've noticed it's easier for students to just go ahead and just do the parentheses first. I'll just let the minus 3 sit there. What do we got? X squared minus x plus 2x minus 2, like that. Combine like terms over here. 2x and 14x is 16x minus 2 plus 28 is plus 26. Over here, what do we got? X squared minus x plus 2x is plus x minus 2. I just combine like terms right there, right? Minus 1x. 2 minus 1 is plus 1x right there. Good. To there. And now let that minus 3 go boom, 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 and distribute through that right side. All right, I'm going to come up here if that's okay. I'm running out of room in a hurry here. So coming up here. So what do we got? We've got the left side is 16x plus 26. The right side, I'm going to let that minus 3 go through. Minus 3x squared minus 3x plus 6, right? I went to this one, and this one with the minus 3. Now what? Everybody know, when you look at this like this, you don't want to do the deer in the headlights and freeze up. What's our next step? What should even be in our mind? Like, where are we going? Where's this trip taking us? Where's the next turn?
Let's try to
get to 0. Get a 0. That's what should be driving in your mind right now. Remember, I wrote the strategy up a minute ago. When you see x squared with an equals, which we're seeing, right? When x squared rears its ugly head all of a sudden in the middle of any problem, there's the sea monster, there's x squared, you need to think, get a 0. That needs to be your instantaneous knee-jerk response. Somebody wakes you up in the middle of the night, x squared with an equal sign, get a 0. It's got to be your first step. Get a 0 or you're not going to get anywhere. So you got to get a 0. As soon as you see x squared, and then, you know, we try to factor or you can do the negative b plus or minus, blah, blah, blah. So either one. So when I look at this, I got to think, oh, x squared with an equal sign, get a 0. So where do I get a 0? Where do I get a 0? Well, I'm going to jump everything to the left side. Why? Because I would like the front term to be positive. So basically, you got to get it all on one side, having nothing on the other side, so you have a 0 on the other side, right? So I'm going to jump all of this stuff over here, over here. Again, why am I going that way? Because it's easier if the front term, the minus 3x squared, he's going to be the front term, is positive. So I'm going to jump everybody to the side where he will be positive. He's the leader. Go to where he's positive. So he'll be positive 3x squared, positive 3x, minus 6, and then these guys,
plus 16x plus 26 equals 0. Does everybody see what happened there?
I just jumped those three. Other side, they change signs when they jump to the other side of the equal sign. And then the 16x and the 26 are just still there. Good?
Mm-hmm.
Now, combine like terms. 3x squared. 3x, 16x, what's that, 19x? Mm-hmm. Minus 6 plus 26 is plus 20 equals 0.
This problem just won't end.
All right. Now, we got to do the whole factoring. If you're a good factorer, do the two parentheses and get a factoring answer. If you're not, do the quad. I think I'm just going to do the quad. That's a harder factoring one because it's got a number in the front. I think the quad's easier than that. So I'm just going to do the quad. Negative b plus or minus square root b squared minus 4ac all over 2a. This is a, b, c. A, B, C. So plug them in. All right, negative B, 19 plus or minus the square root of B squared, 19 squared minus 4 times A times C all over 2A. We good? Coming up here, negative 19 plus or minus square root. 19 squared, is that like 381? 361. All right. 361, the 12, 240, all over 6, so that's minus 19 plus or minus the square root of 121. That looks familiar. That's 11, right? Am I going too quick? You tracking with me?
Give me a second.
All right. 4 times 3 is 12, times 20 is 240, and 19 squared is 361. Subtract them, 121 squared, 121 is 11. The root is gone. Whenever you root something, it vanishes, right? We're almost there. We're so close. So, it's minus 19 plus 11 over 6, and minus 19 minus 11 over 6, which is what? Minus 8 sixths and minus, what, 30 over 6, which is minus 4/3, right? Reduce that. And then this is minus 5. Whew. Here we go. Just as easy as that. Is that good? Do you want to go to calculus? That's got to become fairly easy for you. I'm not exaggerating. This is the reason people don't make it through calculus. Their algebra skills are just too weak. It's not calculus itself. The concepts of calculus are not that bad, but they require this all the time. This is very common in calculus. You need to be able to do this like the back of your hand. You know, you just need no trouble with the quadratic formula. Never mess it up. You never mess up like terms, factoring, common denominators. Just flawless. That's what it takes. I'm trying to be as straight ahead with you as I can. Pete, if you want to go to calculus, you want to do something like that, then you need to practice this. This is more important than all the other weird stuff. It's all this algebra that makes or breaks people in calculus. It's all that. All right.